sānubandhe sati deha-gehe
mamāham
ūḍha-durāgrahāṇām puṁsāṁ sudūraṁ vasato puryāṁ bhajema
sānubandhe sati deha-gehe
mamāham ūḍha-durāgrahāṇām
sudūraṁ vasato puryāṁ
sudūraṁ vasato puryāṁ
bhajema
bhagavan padābjam sānubandhe sati deha-gehe mamāham ūḍha-durāgrahāṇām puṁsāṁ sudūraṁ vasato puryāṁ bhajema bhagavan padābjam sānubandhe sati deha-gehe mamāham ūḍha-durāgrahāṇām puṁsāṁ sudūraṁ vasato puryāṁ bhajema bhagavan padābjam.
Because
sānubandhe,
due to becoming entangled, asati,
thus be,
deha,
the gross material body,
gehe, in the home,
mamā,
mine,
ahaṁ,
I,
iti,
thus,
ūḍha,
great,
deep,
durāgrahāṇām undesirable eagerness,
puṁsāṁ
of persons,
sudūraṁ
far away,
vasatah
dwelling,
api,
although,
puryāṁ
within the body,
bhajema,
let us worship,
therefore,
your
bhagavan,
O Lord,
padābjam,
lotus feet, translation and purport by the one translation. O Lord, persons who are entangled by undesirable eagerness for the temporary body and kinsmen, and who are bound by thoughts of mind and eye, are unable to see your lotus feet, although your lotus feet are situated within their own bodies. But let us take shelter of your lotus feet. Please repeat the translation. O Lord,
persons who are entangled
by undesirable eagerness
for the temporary body
and kinsmen
and who are bound
by thoughts of mind and eye
are unable to see your lotus feet
although your lotus feet
are situated within their own bodies
But let us take shelter of your lotus feet. The whole Vedic philosophy of life is that one should get rid of the material encagement draws in subtle bodies, which only causes one to continue in a condemned life of miseries. This material body continues as long as one is not detached from the false conception of body toward material nature. The impetus for bodily tolerance in nature is the sense of mind and eye. I am the God of all that I survey. So many things I possess, and I shall possess more and more. Who can be richer than I in wealth and education? I am the Master, and I am God. Who else is there but me? All these ideas reflect the philosophy of ahaṁ, mamā, the conception that I am everything. Persons connected by such a conception of life can never get liberation from material bondage. But even a person perpetually condemned to the miseries of material existence can get relief from bondage if he simply agrees to hear only kṛṣṇa-kathā. In the age of Kali, the process of hearing kṛṣṇa-kathā is the most effective means to gain release from unwanted family affection. and thus find permanent freedom in life. The age of Kali is full of sinful reactions, and people are more and more addicted to the politics of this age. But simply by hearing and chanting the Krishna-kathā, one is sure to go back to Godhead. Therefore, people should be trained to hear only Krishna-kathā by all means, in order to get relief from all miseries. Thus ends the Bhagavatam. Om Jnana Jindrāna Sriyāna Jnana Sriyāna Chakshuram Jindrāyam Jena Tasmai Shri Guraya Namaha Nama Om Shishma Vādāya Krishna Krishnaya Bhūtale Shri Madhe Bhakti Vyatanda Swami Nityanāme Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravāni Chāne Nirviche Shāshunyavāni Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Sarasvati Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
So these are prayers offered by Devadas to Lord Vishnu at the beginning of the creation. The devatas are entrusted with certain duties and they are finding it, the situation that they are unable to do their duties. Even though they have been empowered by the Lord, they are unable to do their duties. So in order to perform their duties, they are offering prayers to Vishnu. This is the way a devotee has to conduct himself. Devotees are always engaged in devotional service. But in case they come across a situation where they are unable to do what are they? Their service. Then they have to offer prayers to the Supreme Lord. And prayers generally glorify the Supreme Lord. All prayers generally are in the form of glorification of the Supreme Lord. In these prayers, the devatas are glorifying the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. The whole series of prayers is specially glorifying the lotus feet of God. In this verse, the devatas are telling, persons who are entangled by undesirable eagerness for the temporary body. This body that we have got is a temporary body, material body. And we become entangled in this world because of eagerness to take care of the body, to satisfy the body demands, to take pleasure from the body. And the prayer here is that people become entangled by undesirable eagerness for the kind of body. And it is body, the conception of the body is, I am this body. And regarding the kinsmen, these relatives, we regard our relatives as extension of our own body. My father, my mother, my uncle, my brother, my sister, my. That means, I, conception of I is I'm this body, conception of my something or my relative is extension of my body. So, the feeling or the sense of identity, I am this body and bodily connections are mine. This is for mamāham. Mama, mind, and aham, I. So this leads to entanglement. It leads to entanglement because we are not the body. If I falsely think I am the body, then all my thinking, feeling, willing, my activities, everything is based on falsity, based on a wrong understanding. So if I satisfy my body, I think I will become happy. I will become satisfied. But what happens? Because I am not the body, even though I satisfy my body, I don't become nothing. Even though I satisfy my senses, I don't become satisfied. So this is the defect in such wrong understanding, misunderstanding. And consequently, there is a hard struggle for getting that satisfaction or happiness which we are seeking within. In trying to get that happiness satisfaction, we keep on complicating our life by trying different methods. Just like if I eat one particular edible and I don't get the satisfaction or happiness I am seeking, then I want to try something else. That also doesn't mean then something else, then some other combination. It is this pursuit of happiness through satisfying, trying to satisfy the senses in so many ways that we become entangled. You see so many restaurants, big food industry, packaged foods, so many varieties. Why? Because nobody is satisfied by eating whatever varieties of bhoga they are actually eating. On the other hand, if somebody takes devotional service, then simply by taking prasada, they are completely satisfied. Completely satisfied. That prasada could be something very, very simple. It could be anything, but it is so satisfying. In fact, in the earlier days, when I used to visit the temple, staying outside, I used to visit. I meet all the devotees of my generation, 30 years back. So, in the Bangalore temple, there's a small house. Not small, a big house, but it's a house. There was no temple like what we have today. So, we used to visit the temple on a weekday. Then, in the evening, what is the prasada in the temple? Rice, dal and sabji, three items. Some days there is khichdi and papad. There is a variety. Khichdi and papad or rice, dal, sabji. Even though, before coming, starting to go to the temple, I had eaten in so many restaurants, I never could find the satisfaction of going to the temple and eating that rice dal sabji. It was the simplest prasada or food I have ever tasted in my life. Very, very simple. But never felt it is such a simple thing. What is so special about it? Always felt it was something very, very material. And for that prasadam, the amount of trouble Recently, one devotee was recalling that before this big temple was built in Bangalore, he used to come to the temple in the evening after finishing college some 30 kilometers away, travel that distance for what? To come and taste this prasadam. What prasadam? Rice dal chatni. So what is so special about it? Sometimes people used to wonder that you go to that place and after all what you get is some simple rice dal chatni. For that you are so much eager, so much hankering you have. What is so special about that? Same way, they cannot understand that every day we are chanting the same mantra. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. No different mantra. Same mantra. And same mantra we are again and again chanting. You are not getting bored. One person actually asked me, you don't get bored, Swamiji, chanting the same mantra every day. And so many times you will chant, 1728 times. You will calculation. 16 rounds means 16 into 108 times. So 16 into 108 times you chant every day the same mantra. Yes. And how many years have you been chanting? Some have been chanting 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. There are devotees who have been chanting 50, 60 years also. You don't get bored. How is that? This mantra is not a common sound. Prasadam is not ordinary food. So what is special about prasadam or the holy name, transcendental song? That is actually the food for the soul. That is not only food for, of course it is food for the body also. Prasadam is food for the body also. It nourishes the body. It nourishes the mind, it nourishes the intelligence, it nourishes the soul. That is prasadam. Whereas food which is taken by people, which is not prasadam, which is not of the Krishna, that food, however tasty, however rich, however nicely made, it cannot satisfy the soul. It can never satisfy the soul. At best you can satisfy the senses or the mind, sometimes you can satisfy the intelligence. But food which is not offered to Krishna cannot satisfy the soul. Music or sound vibration which is not connection with Krishna can never satisfy the soul. So this conception of the self as I am this body and conception of what is mind is terms of the bodily relationships. This is a false understanding, it's a misconception. So to get rid of this misconception is not possible simply by some material endeavor, some material arrangement. You cannot get rid of this misconception. And simply by cultivating knowledge or simply by doing some pious activities, doing good to others, being good in this world, or simply by doing some austerity, you cannot. Until and unless the pious activities are offered to Krishna, done as an offering, sacrifice to Krishna, until and unless one cultivates knowledge of Krishna, until and unless one performs austerities for pleasing Krishna, one cannot get any satisfaction for the soul. One cannot come out of misconception of ahaṁ na meti, mamāham. Not possible. So here the demigods are telling, those who are bound by thoughts of I and mine cannot see your lotus feet. even though those lotus feet are right within their own heart, they are unable to see. Yogis who do meditation, they are unable to see the lotus feet of the Lord in the heart as long as they don't take to bhakti yoga, as long as they don't take to devotional service. Any other yoga system, karma yoga, jnana yoga, ashtanga yoga, unless mixed with bhakti, there is no success in that yoga practice. So, success in any yoga practice depends on mixing bhakti with that particular yoga practice. And they want complete satisfaction, complete liberation, ultimate freedom, then they have to actually engage in pure bhakti, not bhakti mixed with karma, jnana, yoga, no. It has to be pure bhakti. Only pure bhakti can satisfy completely the self. Ye ātmā suprasīdati. Ye ātmā suprasīdati in the Bhagavatam. Savai puṁsāṁ paro dharmo yato bhaktir adokṣate ahai dukhi apratihatā ye ātmā suprasīdati. That is complete satisfaction of the self. Atma suprasiddhi is by parodha, by transcendental occupation. What is the transcendental occupation? Yato bhakti radokshate, by which one develops bhakti for adokshatam, devotional service to the transcendental Lord. And such devotional service has to be ahaidaki apratihata. It has to be unmotivated and it has to be uninterrupted to completely satisfy. So that quality of bhakti, ahaidaki apratihata, unmixed, pure devotional service. Normally people pray to God and ask for something in exchange or return. They have a demand to make when they offer prayer, when they go to the temple, when they perform some worship, they do some sacrifice, when they do some vrata, they have something to demand. Either from the devatas or from Krishna. Today is Ganesh Chaturthi, right? So, all over the country or even all over the world, people will be busy worshipping Ganesha. But generally such worship is done with some demand. The name itself is called Vigneshwara. That means he has got the power to remove the obstacles on the path of progress of the people of this world. So people particularly worship him, that all the obstacles on our path of sense gratification be removed. Nobody ever thinks sense gratification itself is poison. So the obstacles that are coming in the path of gratification are good for you. At least it will reduce the amount of poison you are consuming. But foolishly, people go and ask, I want to take poison. I am having so many difficulties in taking poison. Please remove the difficulties. So Ganesha will be laughing. He will be feeling compassion. He will be feeling so much terrible. These people are so foolish. But as a duty, if they follow the rules and regulations, he has to actually award them the desired validation. The devatas, even though they are themselves knowledgeable, but still they are helpless when it comes to giving certain benediction to their worshippers. They are helpless. If somebody does not follow the rules, they cannot give the benediction. And if somebody follows the rules, worshipper may not be good for the person who is asking the benediction. Particularly Lord Shiva, because he is a pure devotee of Krishna. He is always unhappy with his worshippers, always putting in a situation where they ask poison instead of asking for nectar. One demon, he started worshipping Shiva and he wanted the benediction from Shiva that whosoever head he touches, that person's head should be cut off. But he should die immediately, his head should fall to the ground. So Shiva thought, why does this person want this kind of benediction? It's a horrible benediction. Why does he want it? So Shiva was not responding for some time. So this demon was becoming restless. Thinking, oh, Shiva is not satisfied with the amount of austerity I am taking. So let me now start offering the flesh of my own body. So he started cutting off his fingers, cutting off his hand. He was about to cut off his own head. Shiva came and stopped him. To please me, you can just offer one bilva leaf. A little ganga gel you offer. That's enough to satisfy me. Why are you harming yourself in trying to make an offering to me? So the demon said, I want some benediction from you. I want to please you, ask for some benediction. What is the benediction you want? So then he stated, I want to get this benediction. I touch somebody, they should immediately die. So why do you want such a horrible benediction? What? So this demon was not giving up his demand. So Shiva had to actually unwillingly, reluctantly, knowing that it was not good for a demon, still he had to grant him that benediction. And then after he got the benediction, what did this fellow do? So ungrateful. He started chasing Shiva, trying to cut Shiva's head. You see, this is the position of demigod worshippers. Generally, demigod worshippers are very selfish. They are very selfish. And if they ask some benediction, they are asking for themselves. They are not concerned about others' beliefs. Sometimes a person may say, oh, I don't want anything. I'm just praying for my family. Oh, so selfless. He's not asking anything for himself. He's praying, he's working for his family. So he's not selfish. No, he's also selfish. He's praying for his family. He's not praying for somebody else's family. Is it not? So where is his unselfishness? Because he sees his own self as expended in terms of his family members. My wife, my children. Why? My wife, my children are important because they give me pleasure. They are satisfying my false ego. They belong to me. That sense of belonging, my wife, my children. So that is the reason why a person may say, oh, I don't want to be for myself, I want for my family. So it's all selfishness, which is either self-centered or self-extended. This is what I explained in the Bhagavatam. Ahaṁ, mama. Now people will understand, ahamkara is bad. Desiring for oneself, wanting everything for oneself. But they think that if I want for somebody else, I ask, that is good selfishness. But you consider for whom are you asking? Always, other than devotees, non-devotees generally ask either for themselves or they ask for their extended self. my family, my country, my community, my something. Never for somebody else's. Never for the totality of the entire existence. Never for everyone in existence. No. On the other hand, you see a devotee of Chaitanya, Vasudevada. He one day went to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and prayed to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. I want to ask a benediction from him. What is that? That I can't tolerate to see the suffering of others. People in this world do so many sinful actions they have committed in the past. They are suffering so many ways. And they keep on committing sin because when they keep on suffering. I don't see any person. So he prayed to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that you are supremely powerful. Kindly let me suffer for them. You transfer all their sinful reactions onto me and let me suffer and let them be free from all suffering. Let them be free from all suffering. So, this is the perspective of a devotee. He always considers not only himself, he never wants anything for himself. Neither he thinks in terms of my family, my country, my community. No. The totality of all living beings, everyone in existence. And he always desires everyone's well-being, everyone's happiness. That is the vision of the devotee. How is it that a devotee has got such a vision, others don't? That is because a devotee sees everyone and everything in the way of Krishna. Krishna means the sum total of everyone and everything. Other than Krishna, anyone or anything is only a part. The devatas also, if somebody considers the devata has got a limited jurisdiction. Devata may be a controller of a particular department of universal administration. He may have under him certain assistants, subordinates, or his worshippers. Limited. Always limited. Even today, Brahma's jurisdiction is this one universe. But there are millions of universes. So, whose jurisdiction is the totality of the creation, totality of the creation? That is Krishna. So, when you consider Krishna, Krishna means he is not alone. Krishna with all his parts and parcels, with all his energies, with all his devotees, with all his creation. So, only a devotee who has knowledge of Krishna can consider the sum total of all living beings. And everybody always prays for everyone's welfare, for everyone's happiness, for everyone's well-being. And everybody never prays for his own well-being, never prays for his happiness, never prays for his satisfaction, never. So this is the true nature of a devotee of Krishna, a Vaishnava. The Vaishnava is never dukhi on his own account. He is always happy to go to himself. But for other suffering, he feels. He feels unhappy to himself. Always. And he always prays to Lord, please free others from himself. That is why the Lord comes to this world because a devotee prays to the Lord to come and rescue the suffering soul. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came because Advaita Acharya prayed, seeing the suffering condition of the living beings. Advaita Acharya prayed to Krishna, please come and deliver these suffering fellows. There's no hope for them. On their own, or by their collective endeavor, even by the benediction of the devatas, nothing is possible in terms of their deliverance from this material. No devata can do anything. No philanthropist can do anything. No welfare worker can do anything. No United Nations can help them for total deliverance. Only, my dear Lord, you can rescue them, you can save them, you can help them. Please come and deliver them. You know, a devotee is actually powerful to deliver everyone. But out of humility, a devotee thinks that he is not able to. He prays to the Lord, you may guide me as a devotee. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came on the call of the great Acharya. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu started this, inaugurated the Sankirtan movement to deliver all the living entities all over the entire creation. And Chaitanya's devotees also are engaged in the same missionary act of delivering everybody from total deliverance of the total population from all this, complete deliverance, ultimate deliverance. So, this is the difference between devatas and Supreme Lord. Between the worshippers of the devatas and worshippers of Supreme Lord. This difference always exists. That is why in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna explains that kāmai sreshte hṛta-jñāna prapadyante anya devatā. People who surrender to the demigods, or people who worship the demigods, or people who pray to the demigods, generally such people are kāmai sreshte hṛta-jñāna. They are bereft of their intelligence. They have lost their intelligence. They have become foolish because of lusty desires for their own enjoyment. Kama is the spirit. Lusty desires are desires for one's own satisfaction, one's own happiness. These are lusty desires. Such lusty desires, either self-centered or self-extended. This is the business of all demigod worshippers. And those who are not having lusty desires, those who desire real welfare of others, they always worship the Supreme Lord Krishna or Vishnu or Narayana. Because the demigods are helpless. They cannot do anything to deliver the living entities from suffering. Though the demigods have got different powers to give different benedictions to different persons, the demigods cannot give ultimate liberation. Vishnu mukti pradada sarvesham Vishnu eva samshayaha. Shiva declares that if it is ultimate liberation, there is only one person who can give that ultimate liberation, that is Vishnu. In this material world, other than Vishnu, none of the devatas, none of the controllers, none of the universal administrators can give ultimate liberation to anybody. It's only Vishnu. Mukti pradat sarvesham Vishnu eva na samshaya. For everyone, ultimate liberation is given only by Vishnu. And nobody else. Of this, don't have any doubt. So, a devatas, they can only give some temporary benefit, some temporary relief, some temporary happiness, some temporary benefit, that's all. Antavattu phalam tesham tad bhavati alpamevasa. Whatever the demigods are giving as benediction, antavattu phalam tesham, ultimately they are all temporary. There cannot be any permanent belief by the benediction of the demigods, not possible. So, therefore, instead of worshipping demigods, the Bhagavad Gita, the Srimad Bhagavatam, the Vedas recommend worship of Vishnu, worship of the Supreme Personality of God. But still, the Vedas have got recommendations for people to worship Devatas if they are mad after some temporary material benefits. And if they want to be pious. Because simple people, some or the other, they will want to satisfy their demands. Either simply or piously, don't care. But the pious ones, they don't want to sin. They don't want to encroach on others' property. They don't want to have a sinful attitude. So such people are advised by the Shastra. At the same time, such pious people are not ready to surrender to Krishna, are not ready to accept Krishna, are not ready to worship Krishna. So these pious people, for them to gradually bring them to the point of worshipping Krishna, surrendering to Krishna, the Shastra recommend you worship somebody else. But the idea is, by worshipping Devata, they are meant to make progress on the path of gradual advancement towards Krishna consciousness. This is explained in the Bhagavad Gita in the 4th chapter. Even though so many different sacrifices are recommended in the scriptures, ultimately all sacrifices should culminate in transcendental knowledge. All sacrifices culminate. So even sacrifice is not aimed at transcendental knowledge, then such a sacrifice is useless for the purpose. It only further entangles the person. The principle of doing work in this world in such a way that one not get entangled is to do it as a sacrifice to Krishna. But those who are not ready for performing sacrifice to Krishna, for them there is sacrifice to the Devatas which is indirectly sacrificing to Krishna. That sacrifice to Devatas should be done with understanding that Devatas are part of the universal form of the Supreme Law. They are empowered administrators, empowered by Vishnu. So if that understanding is lacking, then sacrifices become merely pious activities which avoid one from material. Temporal and such benefits are ultimately entangling the jiva in this material existence. But bondage is increasing, not reducing, not decreasing the bondage, increasing the bondage. So therefore, the 4th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita explains all sacrifices should ultimately be aimed at Krishna or Krishna. The aim of all sacrifices and in the 9th chapter, the most confidential part, Krishna says, ahaṁ hi sarva yajñānām bhokta ca prabhu eva ca. I am the ultimate enjoyer. I am the controller, the master of all the sacrifices. Even in the 5th chapter, what does Krishna say in the 5th chapter? Bhoktaram yajnatapasam sarvarokam. Because he is the enjoyer of all sacrifices. He is the beneficiary of all kinds of master. Yajnatapasam bhoktaram. So this understanding is very, very, very important if one wants the real length of performing any suffering, doing any worship. So, demigod worship as recommended in the Shastra is not useless if the correct aim is maintained, is understood and carried out. Otherwise, merely following the Vedic scriptures or doing some worship or doing some sacrifice without the proper goal is actually going to be further entangling only. That has to be understood. So here the Devadatta again praying to the Lord that we take shelter of the lotus feet, but there are people who under the conception of I and mine, bodily conception, materialist conception, they are unable to see the lotus feet. They are unable to take shelter of the lotus feet. And because of that, they miss out the real purpose of all their conception. They are unsuccessful, ultimately, in this, in all their endeavors. Mohasham, Mohakarmano, Mohakyanam, Jeev, Saha. Those who are bewildered by the use of energy, they always need to defeat in all their endeavors, in the cultivation of knowledge, in the performance of sacrifices, in their performance of austerities, they are completely defeated. So, if one wants real success in all the areas, then one should aim at Krishna, one should actually give up Krishna consciousness. One should offer everything as a sacrifice to Krishna. One should try to please Krishna by all endeavors. Then only there is real success, ultimate success. Stop. Not even bothering to do that.